teachers, my colleagues. It's a post-lunch session, so I'll make it a bit quick and bit interesting. Just few facts about anatomy. I know most of us would be knowing about it. So Achilles is the thickest and the strongest tendon formed by gastrocnemius and soleus. Gastrocnemius is a fusiform which is formed by two heads, medial and lateral. And the soleus is a large pendant muscle. Together they form a triceps surae. Plantaris is a small vestigial muscle, but still in 65% of the cases it contributes to Achilles complex, as we can see in cadaveric specimens. So the average length of Achilles is around approximately 15 cm. The mean width is around 4 cm at its origin, and it gradually decreases in the midsection. Again, it becomes wider near its attachment, where it has an average width of around 3.4 cm. So the tendon rotates before it get attached to the calcaneus. This is in order, it's like a braided structure in order to give increased biomechanical strength. The medial head of the gastrocnemius forms the posterior aspect, as we can see in the cadaveric specimen. The lateral head of gastrocnemius forms in the middle aspect on the lateral part, and the medial part of the middle aspect is by the soleus. So this is a specimen which can appreciate the attachments. We have all heard, argued, debated about footprints of ACL, PCL and all. Just a short tip on the footprint of tendo Achilles. It forms three aspects. Superficial facet is formed by the retrocalcaneal bursa. Middle is by soleus and lateral head of gastrocnemius. And inferior is by the medial head of gastrocnemius. The implied importance of this is if we deattach the tendo Achilles during surgery, we should take care to reattach all the fascicles as per the facet in order to increase, give proper strength post surgery. Just a short relationship between Achilles and plantar fascia. Many of us Many of us would be would have experienced with chronic heel pain, plantar fasciitis. People do have a lot of calf tightness. So the medial head of gastrocnemius fascicles, they form in, as a periosteum in the continuous layer to the plantar fascia. This is found by a study. As we can see, the medial head, there is a thin layer of around 1 to 2 millimeter of thickness of periosteum, which is continued as a plantar fascia. In the, so as we spoke, plantar fascia is usually attached with calf tightness, TA tightness, and in chronic cases, we do get good results with release of gastrocnemius. Relationship of sural nerve, as we all know, sural nerve crosses the tendo Achilles in the mid part, crosses over laterally. Approximate distance between the sural nerve and the tendo Achilles at the insertion is around 2 cm, more than 2 cm, 4 cm from the insertion is around 11 mm, and as we go proximally, the distance reduces. This is an important fact during percutaneous tendo Achilles repair. We talk about blood supply. Majorly receives blood supply from the musculotendinous junction, surrounding connective tissue, the paratendon, and the osteotendinous junction. The proximal and the distal part is supplied by the posterior tibial artery, and the middle part is supplied by the peroneal artery. The insertion, like we said, is supplied by posterior tibial, mid by the peroneal, and proximal by again by posterior tibial. And the upper neurosis is also supplied by the posterior tibial. We just see the vascular anatomy. The blood, mainly the blood supply of the tendon, the minor vessels, they form up into the paratendon. They mainly arise from the deeper aspect, that is the anterior aspect, and then either they penetrate through the substance or they create an envelope and apply the posterior aspect of the tendon, which is the superficial aspect. So it spreads like a network, as we can see in this specimen. The more proximal we go, there is more blood supply from the anterior part, and distally there is more blood supply from the posterior part. This has an important role during surgery because the posterior part is often dissected and it is to be reattached properly, sutured back properly in order to achieve good healing. The peritoneum is an important vascular supply and it should be closed appropriately, as we can see here. So it's a biological preserving. If we incise the peritoneum, it should be clear, dissected less, sharp dissection, and it should be resutured. There are choke zones, in between the blood supply by peroneal and the posterior tibial, which we call the watershed area, which is more prone to injury. So I'll just quickly jump to the mainly the clinical findings. Most of them have pain, which is at the insertion or 2 to 6 centimeters above the insertion. The pain is worsened after a few steps in the morning, and in chronic cases there is exercise induced pain. There is swelling. Patients have difficulty in walking and doing athletic activities. As we can see, swelling in the retrocanalic region. On palpation, we can find either a thickened cord, a thickened tendon or nodule or crepitus and tenderness. This just for academic purposes, a Royal London Hospital test where we identify the portion of maximum tenderness and ask the patient to actively dorsiflex, and the tenderness reduces. Another sign is painful arc sign. I'll just brush up. For the imaging modalities, the X-ray, I learned from my seniors that the X-rays for the tendo Achilles should be done in standing. If we are going for the ankle, as well include the foot, which is the fastest readily available. We can don't see much of the tendon part, but we do see some soft tissue shadows around, which is the anterior border of Achilles and the Kegel triangle, the fat pad. In cases of rupture, we see the obscuration of the fat pad. Some radiological findings, we see osteophytes, ossifications in the tendon, bursitis or thickening may cause loss of radiolucency, and there is sometimes an inflammatory arthropathy, there is erosion around the attachment. USG is readily available, fast, and better patient tolerability. We can see some longitudinal and transverse sections. These are the fusiform swelling in the tendinosus. On the right lower side, we see the transverse section of the tendinotic this thing. This is a full thickness ACL rupture, or full thickness tendo Achilles rupture. We see proximal and distal end, and the white shadow, we see that it's called acoustic shadowing. Color Doppler, some importance in revascularization, good for checking for the results of healing, more of academic purpose. We come to the MRI. We see sagittal and the axial and coronal sections. More information is gained from the sagittal and axial. This is an anatomical classification described by Chan and Klein and Baxter, where intramuscular, calcaneal and free tendon. Free tendon is the most area where it is injured. As we have talked, some pathological MRI images where we can see the retrocalcaneal spur or Hagelin pump bump with the bursitis with no tear. We see a partial tear in sagittal image and in the axial also, which is superficial. Here we again see in the sagittal images there is a partial tear. The medial aspect of the insertion is still mostly the soleus part is torn. Here we see full thickness insertional tear where we don't find a distal stump. This is again a part of Hagelin deformity with a huge bump with ossification and a complete tear, and some non-insertional tear where you can see the peritoneum is still intact. The proximal stump has become wavy and we still find some distal stump. Some cases where we see calcified tendon or the osteophytes. And last but not the least, plantar pressure analysis. We have found many times that patients with Achilles tendinopathy do have a cavus foot. So it is important to examine the foot arch as well. Thank you.